worship with the words of the grace on page 185 draw us together into this body of Christ. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Almighty God,
to you are our souls, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hidden. Let us thoughts for our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you, and worthy and glorify your holy name, through Christ our Lord.
Yeah. full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as being then yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interest, but to the interest of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but it emptied it himself, taking the form of a slave, being born in human likeness. And being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the time of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. Therefore, my beloved, just as you have always obeyed me, not only in my presence, but much more now in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. For it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
By what authority are you doing these things, and who gave you this authority? Jesus said to them, I will also ask you one question. If you tell me the answer, then I will also tell you by what authority I do these things. Did the baptism of John come from heaven, or was it of human origin? And they argued with one another, if we say from heaven, he will say to us, why didn't you not believe him? But if we say of human origin, we are afraid of the crowd, for all regarded John as a prophet. So they answered Jesus, we do not know. And he said to them, neither will I tell you by what authority I'm doing these things. What do you think? A man had two sons. He went to the first and said, son, go and work in the vineyard today. He answered, I will not. But later he changed his mind and went. The father went to the second and said the same. And he answered, I go, sir. But he did not go. Which of the two did the will of his father? They said, the first. Jesus said to them, truly I tell you, the tax collectors and the prostitutes are going into the kingdom of God ahead of you. For John came to you in the way of righteousness, and you did not believe him. But the tax collectors and the prostitutes believed him. And even after you saw it, you did not change your minds and believe him. This is the gospel of Christ.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ.
And as true as it is that it's never going to be a fit for you because you're you're not that person when it comes to what you wear or how you decorate your home or the car you drive. Paul tells us today that the same is true about our relationship with God. He uses that famous phrase which we hear repeated all the time. We have to work out our own salvation in fear and trembling. We can't take on anyone else's faith. We can't believe the way they do because it isn't true for us and for our situation. We look at some people and we think, oh, I wish I was religious as they are. I wish I was as faithful as they are. I wish I went to church or studied the Bible. For me, I always look at my contemporaries who are ordained the same time as me, and they're always reading all these theological textbooks, and they always seem to know who's the current theologian of the day. You know, I've got like British crime drama sitting beside my bed at night. I have to tell you, I'm not a reader of theology, and I think if only I did that, I would be a better priest, I'd be a better preacher, I'd be a better Christian. But no matter how many of those books I pile up, I start with great intention, and they're all still sitting there. They all have bookmarks that have only moved about this much, and now they just have a lot of dust on them. Now I pile books I want to read on top of them, and that's where they stay. So really the first step in taking on a faith and a salvation that's true for you is really understanding who you really are and knowing that you are not the same as the person sitting next to you in church today. You don't pray the same way. You don't believe the same way. You don't worship in the same way. My best friend is someone who always goes through a lot of jobs. He's never really comfortable. So in his most recent transition, he did up a new CV. Back in my day, they called it a resume, but now they call it CV. So he did up this beautiful CV, and he happened to run into someone who was a professional recruiter, who said, I'll look at your CV for you, and, you know, give you a few pointers. So he read through it, and my friend was very anxious, because he thought, maybe if I just get this piece right, I'll transition into the job of my dreams. So see if you can discover what the recruiter discovered. He listed his various occupations, and he's a highly skilled person. He has multiple degrees. He's bilingual. He's worked in some very important positions in some very well-known companies. So at the end, he writes about how he likes to work collegially and collaboratively. He's a team player. He likes to work with a team, make decisions together, and join together in successes. And then he lists his interests: reading, golf, surfing, and snowboarding. Yes, you've discovered the problem. The last time I checked, snowboarding, golfing, and surfing were not team sports. He isn't really a team player. He just likes to be by himself and work on his own. And this recruiter said to him, you need to find a job where you work from home, and you work in a consultant type of role, or something where you're the boss of you, because you are not a team player. And that's why this job search of yours internally is never, ever going to be a fit. So we need to know who we really are and be honest with ourselves when we think about, what is my faith going to look like? What is my expression of faith going to look like? It has to be true for us. It can't be something that we think other people do. When I used to do my parish visiting, often people would invite me for a meal, for supper, or for lunch. And we sat down. What do you think they would say? Who wants to say grace? Now, sometimes one of the children would pipe up and say, what's grace? So obviously they never said grace any other time. Why were they saying it now? Because the priest was visiting. Or I would say, why don't you use the grace that you usually use here at home? Yes. No. Because it wasn't their faith journey. It wasn't the faith life that they lived in. And that's all right. There isn't a right way or a wrong way, a better way or a less way. That was the faith life that they had evolved into, that they were comfortable. comfortable with, and that marked the relationship they had with God. And that's all right. You see, if we compare ourselves to people who are way better than us, we just give up because we think we're never going to be that religious. If we compare ourselves to people who are worse than us, we get very smug. We think, oh, I've got it. That's great. I'm okay now. We need to find the faith and the salvation path that's the right one for us. And there isn't a right way, there isn't a wrong way. It isn't the past way. It isn't found in any place else but a simple one rule, and that is in conversation with God. The only way you will discover your faith position, your path to salvation, is in a simple conversation with God, like the conversation you would have with your wife or your husband or your partner or your friend, your best friend, your sister, your brother. That's all it's about. I'm always talking to God on a daily basis. Like when I curse, sorry, that's slipped out. I'll do better next time. When I'm careless, when I forget to do something, when I haven't thought about something that's really not very nice, but also when I see something gorgeous, like driving up here today, Lord, thank you for letting me see this beautiful sunny day. That's the relationship I have with God. It's not fancy, it's not perfection, it's certainly not theological. I have a kind of, how would I describe it? I have a kind of Jesus loves me, this I know, relationship with God. And that's how I'm working out my salvation. It's only true for me. And whatever you decide will be true for you and true for your relationship with God. It's the only way you can translate belief into faith. We all have to believe in one thing. And I can condense that down into one prayer. And as the words we say in the Apostles' Creed, as Christians, we have to say we believe in the triune God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, who was born of the Virgin Mary, who suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, was buried, rose again, and gives us eternal life. That is the minimum set of facts that we can believe in to call ourselves Christians. After that, everything is, as my cousin would say, soft furnishings. Whatever else we do about that is individual to us. The creed is belief. How we work it out is faith. Paul tells us today, and I like his words, so I'm going to repeat them, and you'll find them in your bulletin, and I want you to look at them too, because it's the most important thing I think Paul has to say. He says, work out your own salvation in fear and trembling. Why? For it is God who is at work in you. Not anyone else. It's God who is at work in you. And that Greek word, work in you, the word is energeia, from where we get the word energy. So God is expending his energy in you, enabling you to work out your salvation. You're not on your own. God is pouring his energy into you, enabling you to both will and to work for his good pleasure. Paul wrote this letter while he was in prison. He was in prison. So if anyone knew about the difficulties of living out belief into faith, it was Paul. Most of us won't have to face that obstacle of struggling have faith against such huge odds. But all of us face loss, illness, loss of job, loss of loved one, frustration, anger, fear, doubt. But that's okay because God pours his energy into us and he encourages us to find our faith, to work our salvation in fear and
God's presence, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
For the whole people of God, that each one may be true and faithful servants of Christ, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those drawing near to the light of faith, that the Lord will bring them true knowledge of himself, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
In the worldwide Anglican Communion, we pray for the people and clergy of the Diocese of Southern Philippines, Bishop Danilo. In the Diocese of Toronto, we pray for All Saints Church Community Center. And for our own parents' family members, Irene and Dennis Stevenson, Deborah Streisberger, Leona and Jim Walters, Elder and Charles Weller, for our families and friends, that the Lord will give them joy and satisfaction in all that they do. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For those who are lonely, sick, hungry, persecuted, or ignored, that the Lord will comfort and sustain them. Remembering Merlene Dawkins, Walter Youngworth, Gord and Don McHenry, Mary Lorman, John Beck, Doug Young, Christine McLaren, Meredith Fowler, Julie Sharp, Logan McCaughey, Dave, Nicola, Tyson Windrum, Stephanie McKinley, for the recovery and repair in the U.S., Caribbean, Mexico, for the residential schools, for the parish of St. John's, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For our country, that the Lord will help us to contribute to its true growth and well-being. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the whole human family, that we may live together in justice and peace. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
Gracious God, you have heard the prayers of your faithful people, and you know our needs before we ask and our ignorance in asking. Grant our requests as may be best for us. This we ask in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
To continue on page 191, dear friends in Christ, God's steadfast in love and infinite in mercy. He welcomes sinners and invites us to his table. Let us confess our sins confident in God's forgiveness. Most merciful God,
we
Lord.
Amen.
Our Eucharistic prayer is prayer 1, page 193. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right that we should praise you, gracious God, for you created all things. You formed us in your own image, male and female, you created us. When we turn away from you in sin, you do not cease to care for us, but open the path of salvation for all people. You made a covenant with Israel, and through your servants Abraham and Sarah, gave the promise of a blessing to all nations. Through Moses, you led your people from bondage into freedom. Through the prophets, you renewed your promise of salvation. Therefore, with them and with all your saints who have served you in every age, we give thanks and raise our voices to proclaim the glory of your name. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray, our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
like to help in the decoration church. Harvest Thanksgiving here is going to be celebrated on the 15th of October. So if you'd like to donate something to help decorate the church, please speak to Anita Barnes. November the 5th, we will be celebrating Remembrance Day. It's the Sunday closest to the 11th. We don't celebrate things after the event. We try and celebrate them on before. So November the 5th, we'll be celebrating Remembrance Day. And so I invite you to take note of that and be aware of that. Also, we're looking, I'm looking, and I'd love to have some new readers. So if you would, if you can read, and I know you all can, and would like to read in church, I don't care if you're 5 or 95, you are welcome and invited. I would love to have you. It's nice to hear different voices during the liturgy. And as you can see, sometimes our readers and lay readers are doing double and triple duty with reading and intercessing. So I would love to have some new volunteers for that. So please speak to us and let's get you started. Headwaters Hospital is looking for some volunteer chaplains. The information is on the bulletin board on the way into the hall. There is, of course, training, and there's a selection process even before the training, so if that's something you think you might be interested in, the details are there. And I would also draw your attention to the workshops that are being held over with our brothers and sisters at St. Andrew's Anglican. Other announcements.
Elizabeth? I have one from the bishop.
Uh-oh.
I was at area.
Does it involve me and my fire? Is he like,
no, you can't get off that. I was at area council on Thursday night, and the bishop asked if we would bring back to our congregations about our pre-synod meeting. It will be held on Saturday, October the 21st at St. George Allendale in Barrie. He has opened it to anyone who would like to go. He also put a real emphasis on the church wardens and treasurers, just so you know what is going on. There are three of us that are standing for nomination, so he asked us to bring it back to our parishes for the parishes to pray for. The Reverend Aaron Martin is standing for the clergy. Bob Baird, who is from Markham, and myself, who is also standing, and that will mean that we will, if we're elected, to sit on diocesan council as well as area council. So he's asked us to bring it back to our parishes to pray. And
Susan is being on. She's also been nominated to be a representative to provincial synod.
Yes. So. But if you would like to go, I will not be going to pre-synod as I'm going to be away, but Elizabeth is going in my spot, also representing us, but she didn't say that she's not going to be at synod, so we're sort of handing off of the responsibilities, but if you would like to go, you can speak to either Elizabeth or I.
Look at how excited people are about the pre-synod. I see sweeping over there. pre-synod meetings are, they seem like a whole lot, but they've been condensed because now they try and do a half day in one area and the other half of the day in another area, so there's not a lot of messing about. It's strictly business. Our diocese is adopting a new strategic plan. It affects us here at St. John's directly because one part of that strategic plan will dictate how we deal with our real estate and property. So if you are interested in attending, you might think about carpooling since you do have to drive to Barrie, which is an easy drive for me, straight up the 400, but for some of you it might be a bit more detailed. So other announcements. Jim, how are you feeling today, Jim? Are you a bit stiff?
I'm excellent.
You're a child of God. You can be nothing but excellent.
And thank you for leading me into what I was trying to say to you. Yesterday was a beautiful day, as you might recall. And I ran my 5K without having to slow down, walk, or stop even.
Wow. Good for you.
And thanks to the generosity of all the people that helped me with the project, which was to help the people of Pecanicum in Northern Ontario with the issue of not having running water or flushing toilets in their houses. This is a native community in Pecanicum.
$5, you get a full turkey dinner.
And the other thing Audie wanted me to announce, that she's going to be doing the shoe boxes again for the children. I have to find the boxes somewhere. Maybe someone can help me. They're locked away somewhere. But they have to be back by the 13th of November. Does everybody know what I'm talking about, shoe boxes?
Yeah, yeah. Christmas.
That's nothing new to anybody.
Thank you. So you will have found included in your bulletin this morning the financial issue of print is incredibly small. So we try to do everything on one page. You may invite the church wardens just to come up and walk us through it. But as they are doing that, I would invite you to look at the statement. It's important for you because your donations sustain this congregation, and it's important for you to understand how we spend our money, where our money goes. So what you see in front of you is a record to the 17th of August of all of our income and of our expenses. So if you read across the top, August 17th was the date at which this was done. The next column says the budget, and that tells us what we should do to budget in any given month. And you see January to August tells us what we've brought in or expended to that point, and where we should be in our budget at that point in the year, what the variance is, either it's below budget or above budget, and compare it finally in the far right column to the budget that you passed at your last vestry. So you can see that there are some interesting variances, there are some gaps. We are fortunate in that we have some funds that we can draw down on, so we aren't overdrafted in the bank, and all of those are paid. But there are some important things here that you need to take note of, and I'm going to invite your tourists to come forward and share that with you. And then if you have questions or comments, feel free to ask.
Since when the wardens were asked to come and talk, it's very seldom good news. So I will start off by saying that October the 1st is a beautiful day. Also that we don't have any non-current debt. And today is the anniversary of Margaret and I coming to Orangeville 28 years ago.
Oh,
wow. Thank you. And also the reason for us being here is that on October the 17th, we have the priests and the wardens have to go and see the bishop and outline our plans to him. And hear what he has to say. So part of this is to sort of briefly go over this financial priest has mostly done, but so that if you have any ideas, any great plans or something, please let us know. Because it's a time to sort of mastermind, get all the brains working and see if we can come up with some sort of way of increasing our income. Because as you can see on here, August the 17th, under that column, we had income of $6,048. But then you go to the bottom of that column, we had expenses of $10,298, which left us a deficit of $4,250. Going over to the third column, you can see from January to August the 17th, our income was $95,371. Our expenses were $141,143, which left us a deficit of $45,772, which this is our problem, the monthly operational costs. That's where we have our problem. Because we do have some funds, as you probably know, in our operating account at this point, we have, this is on the back side of that page, we have 36,000 in the bank, but on checking on the 27th of September, that's down to 33,000. And there may be some outstanding checks that I don't know about. The $65,000, $65,456, is what's remaining from Lloyd Kershaw's estate. Now, this is money that we can take, and this is what we're keeping us afloat so that we haven't been running into debt. But as you can see, if we have to take $4,000 a month from that, it's only like, say, some 15 months in the future, and we're out of debt, we're out of funds. So we've got to find some way of not taking money from that, just keep it more as an emergency. It shows then further that we've got $88,848 from
good at math. I failed it in high school. But just generally on a monthly basis, how much are we short?
4,200.
Thank you very much. Just needed the figure. Okay.
On an average.
Is there anything else people don't understand? These are complex statements. Don't feel like that you're foolish if you don't know the answer. That was a great question, Teresa. Unless we know the information, it can't really be helpful. So if there's something, if you don't understand it, if you don't ask in this venue, feel free during the coffee hour to speak to myself or one of the church wardens and ask them if you're not here or give them a suggestion if you're not comfortable speaking here. But if there's any question you have that might be a benefit to everybody that's listening, feel free to ask.
Any more questions? Benny, what we're going to be in there for coffee anyway, so if anybody wants to come up and go over this with us.
Yeah, one of these days you will be asked to come up here and announce good news. Thank you.